Zen Kappa Power.
The extreme sport of skateboarding has been around for quite some time, but exploded in popularity in the 1990s. From magazines, to movies, to TV shows, to the X Games, skateboarding's popularity skyrocketed thanks to the skaters themselves. Personalities like Chad Muska, Rodney Mullen, Bob Burnquist, or Eric Kosten were all at the forefront of skating in the mid to late 90s, with one standing out amongst the rest, Tony Hawk. Not only was the public eye on skating's rising popularity, but also the suits over at Activision, who struck a deal with Mr. Hawk for development to begin on a video game. That video game would become Tony Hawk's Pro Skater, developed by Neversoft. Pro Skater was immensely popular, causing Activision to greenlight a sequel as well as other games in the extreme sport genre, such as Pro BMX or Pro Surfer titles. Pro Skater's popularity spawned four titles under that moniker, leading to games throughout the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th generation of consoles. While I've dabbled in future titles and had my fair share of memories with Pro Skaters 1, 2, and 3, one title has always stood out to me as one of my favorites, and that's Tony Hawk's Underground. Underground marks a lot of firsts for the series. It's the first real narrative-driven game in the franchise. It's the first title in the series to focus on a personal custom skater rather than the big-name skaters of previous titles. It's the first sandbox-style game in the series, and it's the first game that allows players to get off their board. Underground's story revolves around two young skaters trying to make it big. It's a setup that really resonated with me when I was younger, and I can only assume that a lot of older kids or younger teenagers at the time as well. I was fascinated by the sport, so much so my parents actually went out and bought a cheap board at Walmart that I spray-painted baby blue with the Plan B logo on it. Of course, being an unathletic nerd, I could never really get a handle on it, which led me to live vicariously through Tony Hawk and his friends. This is where Underground shined for my younger self. Before EA's Skate series manifested, Tony Hawk's Underground gave me and others the ability to create a skater and skate their way to the top. Granted, the narrative is as, if not more so, wackier than some of the activities you would partake in the previous games, but the RPG-like aspect of Underground is what stuck with me throughout the years. Starting as ordinary teens dreaming big, you try to impress all the right people with your skating moves, roughing it from competition to competition, from city to city. It's kind of similar to the background story elements of Rock Band, as weird of a comparison as that might sound. The story sees you and your best friend Eric Sparrow on your own rise to fame through impressing big name skaters like Chad Muska or the Birdman himself. Shenanigans ensue, which usually propels the plot forward. It doesn't take itself seriously in the ways a Tony Hawk game should, if that makes sense. It's endearing to see your skater getting praise from the pros, but it's also not afraid to have characters jump over a bridge to avoid the cops or have them set a taxi on fire to do tricks over. Slowly but surely, you start to realize that Eric rarely has your interests in mind, culminating in a rivalry towards the end of the game. The narrative does its job and frames all the wacky skateboarding antics in a different light and allows players to feel a bit more agency than in previous games, which is appreciated. That agency is also felt through the extensive customization aspect. Character customization is a big part of Underground. All the usual options are here: hairstyles, facial hair, shirts and pants, hats, shoes and socks, backpacks, tattoos, you name it. Plus, that silly underlying tone Tony Hawk games have is here as well. Being able to wear goofy hats or backpacks or dress your skater up as almost anything is always fun. This is extended to your deck as well. While there's a small amount of customization options, it opens up as you win more competitions and get more sponsorship opportunities. It's a big part of real-life skateboarding, so the ability to trick out your tape, wheels, and everything is another aspect that Underground nails to give it that role-playing feel. I gotta say, it's refreshing how many options there are. If Underground was released today, Activision would riddle this game with microtransactions. The extensive customization doesn't just apply to characters or boards, but tricks as well. Players can string together various moves and inputs to create their own unique trick to pull off. It's a pretty neat feature to mess around with, and being able to create a trick and pull it off is similar to how new tricks were created in general. It's a small but effective touch that exudes that underdog aspiring skater theme Underground is built upon. Sports games aren't usually played for their story or characters, so the gameplay is the pillar in which Tony Hawk Underground acid drops in from. Tony Hawk games are arcade games at heart. Time challenges and varying locations that have the player pulling off tricks and combos to rack up the score as much as possible. There are various ways of pulling off said tricks, whether that's flip tricks of the kick or heel variety, grab tricks like nose grabs or airwalks, and grinding on rails from various angles, just to name a few. The beauty in Tony Hawk games is pulling off these moves continuously in a combo. Ollie onto a rail, grind down it, kickflip off into a manual, or going off a ramp and pulling off a 540 Indy grab. Roping together combos can be addicting, stringing together flips, grabs, grinds, manuals, transfers, reverts, all together to get a massive combo score. It's akin to a fighting game of sorts, inputting directional or button prompts in specific ways to pull off everything from a simple melon to a McTwist. There's an extensive list of moves from the traditional to the extreme, and they're all fun to pull off. It's greatly satisfying to ollie onto a bench, manual down it, heel flip onto a rail, and grind away. The give and take with Tony Hawk games is keeping that combo going, but risking all your points you've accrued by bailing. Hitting a sick 20,000 plus point combo only to blow it on the landing is where the fun and frustration can come from Tony Hawk games, and this extends to Underground as well. Being able to master the mechanics to pull off impressive combos is not only innately satisfying, but rewarding as well. The RPG aspects I mentioned earlier are another way Underground sets itself apart. While stat points were a part of the Pro Skater series in a way, Underground has a checklist of sorts from all the various abilities like grabs, manuals, or flips. Completing these challenges grants the player a stat increase in whatever category the challenge is in. Pulling off an impressive 10 second manual or 6,000 point grab combo will reward you with a stat boost, making pulling off those combos even easier. Traditionally, Tony Hawk games prior to Underground would place the player in a relatively compact space, focused on several challenges from collecting the 5 skate letters to random other tasks. It was tight-knit and focused on pure arcade fun. Underground takes that core concept and spreads it out across more open levels. Places like New Jersey, New York, Florida, Hawaii, or Vancouver are all playable areas and offer a more open world style of gameplay not yet seen in the series up to that point. Like I said before, most of what Underground does well is essentially EA's Skate series in its entirety, and while I would say objectively Skate is the better series, they both do things a little differently. Comparing Pro Skater or Underground to Skate is like comparing NFL Street to Madden. Conceptually, they're the same, but the ways they approach their gameplay, story, and level design are a bit different. The more open levels means more freedom for the player. It's just fun exploring each level and finding cool spots to hit tricks, or finding secret tapes and the like. The core gameplay is fun enough that there's no need for any contextual quests or challenges, and I find myself grinding around, manualing down streets, wall riding, and generally pulling off fun combos in my time between missions. The non-linear aspect of Underground's levels gives this feel of believability, where ramps, rails, or bowls are built into the environment in some unique ways. Parks, empty swimming pools, chain-link fences or benches, monuments, drainage ditches, or party boats. There's a lot of variety squeezed out of the locales in Underground that makes each level feel unique while ostensibly being very similar, usually a small town or a section of some city. The levels are more playgrounds than obstacle courses, and the level design is exemplified by some new additions to the series. Players now have the ability to skitch on cars, being able to reach unprecedented speed and blast off ramps. The ability to wall plant is not only cool to look at, but can also save you from bailing on an awkward jump or angle. The best of these new additions is the ability to get off your board. As simple as that might be, it changes a lot of things about the core gameplay. I could not tell you how many times I would get stuck somewhere in a level in the previous games and had to awkwardly turn around and kept bouncing off of walls and whatnot. In Underground, you simply can just jump off your board and reposition yourself. Once off your board, you can jump and climb all over, which means you can get to hard to reach spots and don't have to rely on the somewhat unreliable physics of the game anymore. You can also jump into and out of tricks, which adds a whole other element to combos. Jumping towards a rail and grinding and heel flipping off is extremely satisfying. While some of the quote-unquote platforming can be extremely janky at times, it's not a core part of the game by any means, and once you grapple with the bizarre controls, it's easy to climb ladders, jump over gaps, or climb up buildings. To progress in the story, a certain number of tasks have to be completed, similar to something like Mario 64. Man, these analogies are all over the place today. Players have a group of challenges that they can tackle in whatever order they choose. For example, let's just say a level contains 6 different challenges, but only 4 are needed to progress. This is constant throughout the story, not only making each playthrough from player to player different depending on what challenges they accept, but also gives the player some leeway in which challenges they want to do. It's neat that the game sets players loose in these open levels and makes them explore for each mission to do next. There's also a handy goal list to pick and choose from for those who are impatient or lost. The option is really nice and is sort of ahead of its time almost. While each challenge differs, most are your traditional get X amount of points in the allotted time, framed as impressing various skaters or in skate competitions. Some challenges have you collecting things such as gear or pieces of a skateboard. My favorites have to be the trick sets, where you have to perform whatever trick pops up on screen in an allotted time. Some are similar to the random challenges from the Pro Skater series, like delivering dry cleaning, taking a dog for a walk, or knocking down all the bottles in a single grind. While they're nothing truly special, the majority utilize the mechanics of Underground in some great ways. To be fair, there are some bad challenges here, mostly stemming from some of the new mechanics to Underground. For whatever reason, Neversoft implemented driving sections into a Tony Hawk game. It's both loose and tight somehow, and it feels just so out of place, like a poorly designed crazy taxi. Luckily, the driving sections aren't too offensive, and they're usually easy enough to get through if you have to. It's an unfortunate mark on an otherwise entertaining game. The Pro Skater series was known for some fantastic soundtracks. Underground doesn't disappoint in this department. Similar to most sports games, the soundtrack is a curated list of have almost 70 tracks of licensed music from various artists. Genres like rap, punk, and rock play in the background as you skate, and it complements the gameplay well. Now, I can't really show you what I mean. I recommend playing the game and listening to the soundtrack in the background. It's a great collection of different feeling music that pairs really well with the gameplay. Graphically, I'd say Underground holds up as well as a PS2 game can. It's stylized in a way that it's grounded in some sort of reality but never hindered by it. The UI and menus give off that extreme feel, and you can even change them to different looks, which is a really great touch. Animations are both believable and over the top, my favorites being when bailing on a trick as your player breaks their board, slams into the ground, or worse. The levels I mentioned previously having structures built into the environment that oddly resemble ramps or grinding rails that otherwise wouldn't. Sure, it has its oddities like some bad facial animations, but overall the visuals do their job well. With the Pro Skater series being beloved by fans and critics alike, it must have been a tall task over at Neversoft to both push the franchise forward while also staying close to its roots. Underground is a great successor to the Pro Skater series, taking what the series did and building off of not only its mechanics, but also expanding its scope and scale. And while it's not perfect, it's one of my favorites in the series, and I still had fun playing it to this day. With the remaster of Pro Skater 1 and 2 right around the corner, hopefully Activision can wipe away the stink of Pro Skater 5 and return the Birdman to his perch atop the extreme sports video game genre.